Well, we are in part two of a series called God Is. Erin, my wonderful wife and our co-lead pastor, crushed it last week when she talked about God's mercy. That was so awesome. If you missed it, I encourage you to check out our podcast, our YouTube channel, and watch that or listen to it. It is fantastic. I listen to podcasts on two speed, and so hearing my wife talk in two speed was crazy. I was like, wow, that's kind of how she always sound. I'm joking. But with that being said, I am pumped for this series. But I have a question for us today. What keeps you up at night? Can I get an amen on that one? Sheesh. Other than your children, what keeps you up at night? What makes your mind race? When you're trying to shut off your mind and relax, what do you worry about? Life happens, things beyond our control happen, and it can make us feel worried. It can make us feel concerned. Who in here is you ever just kind of worry just a little bit? Like some things happen, right? You get a little nervous about the future. You don't know. Here you go. There's this one particular time, probably one of the most stressful situations I've ever been in. It happened two years ago now, in 2020. A lot of crazy things happened in 2020. But this one was particularly crazy because Erin and I in Kingsley, we were hanging out in our deck of our old house, and we lived in the West End area, and we were doing some crafts in our backyard, and then Erin, who is around 5 months pregnant with Jameson at this point, goes inside because she needs a snack. So she's like, I need a snack ASAP. So she goes inside, and while I'm outside with Kingsley, all of a sudden I hear this loud crash inside. And so I'm like, oh my gosh. So I hurry up and I run inside to find Erin on the ground screaming, saying, my arm, I broke my arm. And I'm like, oh my gosh. So I run up to her, my heart's racing, she's holding her arm, and then Erin, being the most amazing woman, most amazing mom in the world, stops thinking about her literally broken arm that she just got, and then is instantly concerned about the baby. She says to me, I think I fell on my stomach, I'm not sure, I try to catch myself, and so what do we do? Obviously, we're stressed, we're worried, we don't know what's happening. So we obviously hop right in the car, and then we're driving to the hospital. And as we're driving, Erin is freaking out, thinking about the baby. And I'm telling her, it's fine. I'm saying that on the outside, but on the inside, I'm worried. I actually don't know if it's fine. I don't know. I know the sound of her falling was pretty hard. I don't know how it went. So here you go. So we get to the hospital, and we pull up to the hospital off of the West Creek exit. And guess what? That hospital is closed because of COVID. And we're like, oh my gosh. And so then we had to drive all the way to Short Pump, we had to drive to Short Pump, but it felt like forever because we don't know what's happening. So we get there, we walk to the ER area, and then instantly Kingsley and I cannot walk in because of COVID protocols. So now Erin's by herself, they take her in the back, and then they check her arm, and the whole time Erin's like, I know my arm's broken. I'm not that concerned about my arm. Can we hear the heartbeat? And so after what felt like forever, they finally check the heartbeat, and they hear Jameson's heartbeat. But for that probably 2 hours, I was pretty worried. We were both pretty worried. The relief we felt when we heard the good news was great. But Erin texted me while I was in the parking lot with Kingsley, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is so good. And then I had to spend 2 hours in a parking lot with Kingsley. That part wasn't good. But everything worked out. As we see our son Jameson, who's always running around here, everything worked out. But it was crazy. And truthfully, doesn't worry kind of happen like that? Doesn't stress kind of happen like that? Worry is the result of uncontrollable things you wish that did not happen happening. It's the presence of things that you wish wouldn't happen starting to ease their way into your current reality. And when we feel like things are about to happen, especially things that we cannot control, there comes stress, there comes anxiety, there comes this worry. And here you go. All it takes for us today is to turn on the news. We turn the news and we see wars. We see political unrest, economic uncertainty, racial injustice. And maybe for you, it's personal. Maybe you have an aging parent and you're taking care of them. Or that you're waiting to hear a doctor report and you're hoping this time it will be good. Or maybe your kids keep you up all night. Or maybe it's for you, is if can I pay the bills? Or if you're a college student and you're looking at the debt you're accumulating, you're like, I hope I get a job after this. Or maybe you're currently having a job and you're hoping I can keep this job that I have. See, maybe for you it's something different. Maybe you're worried about, is my life ever going to make a difference? Will I find my purpose? Some of you are going and thinking to yourself, man, I didn't really have any worries until you listed all the things I should be worried about. To that, I'm sorry. I'm joking. but again, I ask, what are you worried about? What are you worried about? For me, my biggest worry, if I can be honest, I like to be honest at church. If I can't be honest at church, I guess I'll just go somewhere else. But I feel like I should be honest here. For me, the thing that I'm most worried about, there's two things that I'm most worried about. And the first one is, am I going to be a good husband and dad? I worry about that. Sometimes I just think to myself, like, I hope I continue to do the right thing. I hope I continue to love my wife and my kids the way God wants me to. But then I also pray that the personal struggles that I have and insecurities that I still deal with, I hope that God continues to help me overcome them so I can be the person that God has called me to be. I also worry about the church. I worry about you guys. I worry about, is our church going to grow? Are we going to make a difference in our community? Those are the things that I worry about, if I can be honest today. Now, let me ask you this, though. For a second, what is the thing that you do worry about? And let it hang there. What is that thing that you worry about? Do you have it? Do you know what it is? Here you go. I ask that question because what we worry about the most often reveals where we trust God the least. What we worry about the most often reveals where we trust God the least. And I don't like that. So we gotta make a difference. And Jesus says this to us as Jesus followers in Matthew 6, 25 says this. This is so good. I love this. He says, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life. I can stop the message right there. Do not worry about your life. Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? You know you can't. You know you can't. Corey Ten Boom, who spent time as a child in a concentration camp, who is also a follower of Jesus, said this about worrying. Worrying doesn't empty tomorrow of its sorrow. It empties today of its strength. Come on, man. So we've all experienced that feeling, and that's why today we are talking about living without worry. We're going to live a life without worry. Now, that's hard. That's challenging. But do we know that our God gives us the ability to do hard things? Did you know that the God that you serve was buried in a tomb, rose from the grave, defeated death, and if he did all those things, he can be with you in your worry? Come on, man. I feel like preaching today. I feel like preaching a little bit today. Because I'm going to tell you, I don't even need my notes right now. The reason why I feel like preaching a little bit today, because there is an enemy who is active and out and trying to get people discouraged, trying to take people out of the game, trying to tell you that your life doesn't matter, trying to tell you to stop living for your dreams, trying to tell you that you just got to give up and settle for second best. And I'm going to tell you today that God has called you, he's anointed you, and he's appointed you for such a time as this. Come on, somebody. Come on, man. We're not going to live a life of worry when we serve a God who holds creation in his hands. We're not going to live a life consumed with our anxiety and fear and stress and the what if this happens when we serve a God who already holds the victory in his hand. Come on, I'm preaching today. We're going to live a life without worry. That sounds pretty good to me. But living a life without worry, we must answer a foundational question that humanity had to answer. In fact, is one of the first questions that we see humanity deal with in the book of Genesis. And I want you to get this. Genesis chapter 2 says this: God created Adam. He made him rule over the earth. He said, you can eat from any tree in the garden except that one tree. You can eat from the watermelon tree. Do watermelons grow on tree? I think it's a bush. I don't know, man. I don't know where watermelon come from. I just know it's juicy and delicious. Here we go. Then he creates the animal. And then God creates Eve. And Adam is like, wow, man, you know, I love this girl. Come on. And then Eve is in the garden one day. And then this new character in Genesis all of a sudden pops up. This new character in Genesis chapter 3 is the serpent. This serpent pops up out of nowhere, and then I want you to get this. I want you to lean in. I want you to get this. Then the serpent begins to talk to Eve, and here's what the serpent says. The serpent says, did God really say? Did God really say you can't eat from that tree? Maybe he said something a little different. See, what we see it's something that the enemy still does today. What he does, the serpent introduced a question to Eve. He said, did God really say? And the question that the serpent introduced to Eve was this: is God really trustworthy? Is God really trustworthy? Can you trust this God? Is he a trustworthy God? And a few verses later, Eve is in the garden and says, man, that tree does look kind of good. Man, those fruit on that tree look pretty tasty. It is pleasing to the eye and is desirable for gaining wisdom. And she had a choice to make. And friends, we have a choice to make every day. Are we going to choose what God says? Are we going to choose what's just desirable to the eye? Are we going to choose what God says about us? Are we going to choose what our fear is trying to convince us of? Are we going to choose that God says, I am more than a conqueror through Christ who gives me strength? Are we going to choose to believe that, yeah, I'll always be the mess up, I'll always be the failure, I'll always be the person that's never quite good enough? Am I going to trust God, or am I going to trust what I see? Am I going to trust God, or am I going to trust what I can touch? Am I going to trust God, or am I going to trust what I desire? Am I going to trust God, or am I going to trust what I can control? And the funny thing is, the more you try to control things, the more you realize you have no control. Every single one of us has to answer that question: is God trustworthy? And I love what the psalm writer says. Psalm 62 says, my salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock. Come on, my refuge. Trust in him at all times. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge. I love this, because when should we trust God? Should we trust him when things are just going good? Should we trust him when things are, when the plans are smooth? Should we trust him when my kids listen to me the first time? No, in all times. In all times. We must trust God even when things don't make sense, when life feels out of control. And I actually think a big portion of your walk with Jesus is learning how to trust God. I think a big portion of it is just learning how, today, God, how can I take one obedient step towards you? How can I just follow you today? Because here's the truth: God is trustworthy. God is trustworthy. And you may be like, well, Jacob, how can you say that? I'm still single. I'm still struggling with the same issues I had when I was 13. I'm still not where I want to be. And there's so many problems in this world. How can you say that God is trustworthy? Well, what I want to do real fast, I want to give us three reasons. Three reasons why we can trust God. There's more than three reasons. Bonds don't give us three reasons that you can use to get a good perspective on why you should trust God. And the first one is this: because God was faithful before. God was faithful before. I love when we do the worship sets, and sometimes Nick and I don't talk about the sets. And I love when he picks songs that match up directly to the message. I love that bridge in that song we were singing, that he goes before us, he's in front of us, he's beside us. Here you go. How can you know that God is trustworthy? Because he was faithful before. He was faithful before. There's this theme we read in the Old Testament portion of the Bible. There's this theme of God reminding his people to remember. reminding his people to remember. Exodus 13:3 says this, and Moses said to the people, remember this day. Remember this day. And for some of us, we need to start remembering the good things. We need to start remembering the good things. It's easy to remember the bad things. Who in here stresses out about good things? No one does. But we do all the time. We dwell on problems. We fix our thoughts on things we have no control over. But in order for you to find the life that you really want, you must get good at remembering the good things. You got to get good at remembering the good things. See, every day, one thing I try to do, every day I try to spend at least 5 to 10 minutes a day in silence and solitude with God. So I try to have no music, no noise. It's very hard when you have a lot of kids. You know, I try to just get away and spend time with the Lord. The other day I was spending time with the Lord, and afterwards I got back into the living room, and Erin asked me, she said, well, how was spending time with Jesus? And I said, it was amazing. It was amazing. And she said, oh, why? What did he tell you? Did he tell you something? And I was like, no. Mm-mm. He didn't say nothing. And she was like, then why was it amazing? And I said to her, because for 10 minutes, I just remembered and recapped all the fun we had with our kids at Great Wolf Lodge last weekend. I just remember how much fun Kingsley had on her birthday. I thought about how much she smiled, how much she laughed, how Jameson loved the water when he got in there, how Hayden was such a good little boy the whole time. See, one of the most spiritual things you can do is taking time to think about the good things God is doing. It's taking time to think about the good things God is doing. Sometimes we look for God to speak, like, God, speak to me about my future. God, change this. And God's just like, can you remember what I've been doing the whole time? Can you just be looking at what I'm doing right now? Can you be don't make God like how the world is trying to make the world. What do I mean by that? The world is always making you look for the next thing. You get the iPhone 13, guess what? The 14 coming out next fall. You got to always go for the next thing and the next thing and the next big thing, the next big thing. Oh, you done with, we got people graduating high school. You done with high school? You going to college? Oh, you going to college? What job are you going to get? After you get a job, when you going to get married? When you get married, when you going to have babies? After you have babies, when you going to get your sanity back? Everyone's always thinking you look for the next thing. And God is saying, sometimes I'm not in the next thing. I'm in the thing I've already done. Sometimes I'm in the thing I'm already done, and we need to get good at stopping and thinking and reflecting and being thankful for what God has already done in our lives. See, we live in a world of hurry up. We live in a world that's never satisfied, on to the next thing, and you wonder why you're so anxious. You wonder why you're so dissatisfied, and you wonder why you never feel good about yourself. The Apostle Paul says this, whatever is noble, whatever is good, whatever is admirable, lovely, pure, think about those things. Remembering those things. Remember when God was faithful. Remember when you didn't have hope and now you do. Don't overcomplicate your spiritual connection to God. We let stress, worry, problematic people live rent-free in our brains too often. You evict those thoughts by intentionally thinking about the good that God is doing. Because he's good. He's good. Moses says, remember this day in which you departed from Egypt, from the house of slavery, for by the powerful hand of the Lord brought you out of this place. Remember the fact, this is what Moses is saying to the Israelites, remember the fact that when you cried out for mercy, God heard your cry. Remember that God delivers you from the most powerful ruler on the face of earth. Remember the fact when you got to the Red Sea, you were stopped by the water, and God said, I ain't stopped. You were stopped by the water, but God wasn't stopped with his promise. You may be right now facing something, and you think, I feel stopped, I feel stuck, I feel like I can't make it. You may think you're stuck in the natural, but God in the supernatural is parting the seas for you today. You aren't stuck when God is with you. And then God parts the seas when they cross on dry land. God stops the most powerful military force on earth. Remember when you got to the wilderness, God led you by a cloud a day and by a fire at night. Remember when you were thirsty, God provided water. Remember when you were hungry, God provided manna for you to eat. Remember that God has been faithful before. He's been faithful remember that our God is trustworthy and he can do it. Again, one thing you see in the Old Testament too is when God works his power, when God does something that amazes the people, what they would do, they would stop wherever they were and they will make a monument. They would make a monument of stones and they would build this little stone thing they had. And the reason why they would build it is because as they were going on through their normal everyday life, they would walk by that thing and they will remember when God did something good. Friends, what pile of stones do you need to start building in your life? What pile of stones do you need to start building in your life and remember that this is where I was and then God came through for me? This is what I had and then God came through for me. This is where my life was heading, come on. And this is where God came through for me. Oh, look at this. Look at this. This is what it looked like. Just some stones. Just some stones. Get your stones. Don't get stoned. I'm joking. Do what you want to do. Okay. Maybe, here you go. Maybe when he's radically transformed your life, maybe that's a stone you lay down. Maybe it's when your child was baptized. That's a stone you lay down. A story that always reminds, gives me faith in my life and for our church is our local miracle gift we did last December. When I was praying about doing our miracle gift, a miracle gift was literally the farthest thing from my mind of doing. And the reason why is because when we reopened as a church in September, we were actually losing money every month. We were losing money every month. To reopen ended up costing way more than what we budgeted for. And so I obviously was stressed out. I was like, oh, Lord. I was stressed out. And so I was praying about doing an end-of-the-year giving campaign, if I'm being honest. That's what I wanted to do, is an end-of-the-year giving campaign so we can budget with margin in 2022. So as I was praying, I felt this impression of the Holy Spirit say, yeah, do a giving campaign, but give it all away. And I was like, God, don't you know your church needs money? And then it was funny because instantly, right when I felt that, I knew exactly who God wanted us to give the money to. I knew exactly what we could do. Here's the crazy part. I called Ken, who is a Vineyard pastor in South Richmond, who has a reading program for African American kids. That's who we want in the sponsor called Matthew's Place. And I'm not lying. I call him. I tell him what we're thinking, what we want to do. And he literally says to me, he says, Jacob, today I was praying for God to give us funds so we can keep this thing going. Isn't that amazing? And then guess what? We end up, as a church, you guys, we raised $3,000 to just give away. That's a lot for our church, okay? We raised $3,000 to give away. But here's the best part, and I don't think I've told you guys this part of the story yet. After doing that, literally after doing that, and we haven't even made it public yet that this is what we're doing, just God knew we were doing this, and this is what we started doing. After making that happen, I get a call from a pastor in Connecticut. And he says, Jacob, I believe in what God's doing in Richmond. We're going to send you guys a check for $5,000. I was like, what? That's insane. Then, hey, it gets even better. So then we get another call from a Vineyard pastor up in Northern Virginia. He says, Jacob, I love what God's doing in Richmond. Here's a check for $7,500. I'm like, what the heck? And here's the best part. This is the part that's my favorite. People in our church started tithing. And the reason why I love that, because tithing means people are being obedient to what God wants them to do. And every month, here you go, every month in 2021, we didn't hit our budget goals. We had low costs in 2021 because we were online. But since December, we have surpassed budget goals every single month. See, there's something about when you trust God. You say, God, I'm going to be faithful. Even though I don't understand, I'm going to be faithful in what you're calling me to do. That's why we got this prayer board down here. We got this prayer board that's filled with requests. I want you guys to do something for me. I want you to fill that thing up with the craziest prayer requests that you got. I want you to fill that thing up with prayer requests that you thinking to myself, why am I writing this down? And here you go. Here's the reason why. One, because we serve a miracle-giving God. We serve a God who makes miracles happen. And I want us to be a church that nags God a little bit. That says, God, I need you to come through for me. I need you to come through for my family. I need you to come through for what's happening in my life. Something that Aaron and I, something that we're nagging God about is a couple in our church who live in Virginia Beach, they got the worst news any parent can get. The worst news any parent can get. Their little baby boy, Cooper, was just diagnosed with a terminal disease. So rare, in fact, that there's been no survivors, and he's 1.5, and they're only giving him a few more years to live. So here you go. I love medicine, and I pray that they can find a cure in this process, but I can't wait for medicine to find the cure. I got to nag God for a miracle. I got to bring it to him to heal this boy, to be with the family. So you want to know what? Every day, every Sunday, that's where my prayer request is going to be. And I encourage you guys, get rowdy about your prayer requests. Get rowdy about it, because we don't serve a limited God. We serve an all-powerful God. Get courageous in your prayers. And in the process, we will trust God. Here you go. Second one. I'm going to go through these next two pretty fast. God is faithful today. God is faithful today. James, you can play a little tune for us on the keyboard. Just not Stevie Wonder. That'll get us all dancing. I don't know why I said that, but I did. James, you know any Stevie Wonder? You might know something. Okay, I'm right. Ray Charles? Oh, no, he knows Ray Charles. Okay, never mind. What am I talking about? God is faithful today. God led the Israelite people to the edge of the promised land. Joshua, one of the leaders, stands up before the people and says this in Numbers 14. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them. Man. There is a real enemy. Scripture tells us he's out to kill, steal, and destroy. And I'm going to tell you guys this. The thing that you're struggling with in your life, it could be because of some bad habits. It could be because some not right ways of thinking. Or it could be because there is an enemy that does not want you to succeed in this life. That's trying to tear you down. But this Bible verse reminds us. It was a foretelling of what Jesus would do on the cross. He said the enemy, the ways that protection is gone. They don't have protection. The Lord, Emmanuel, God with us, Jesus, he is with us. Do not be afraid. See, Joshua understood something, that our success is not dependent on what we see. Our success is not dependent on the size of our opposition. Our success is dependent on the presence of God in our lives. It's dependent on the presence of God in our lives. And the good news is that is Jesus. The first chapter of Matthew tells us, it gets straight to the point. It says, behold, a virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. The good news of Jesus is he's with you. He is with us. Matthew 28, Jesus' last words to his disciples, he says, and surely I will be with you always, even until the very end of the age. The good news of Jesus is this, is that he is with us, that he is an ever-present God, and he is for us. I want you to soak this in, what I'm about to say. I want you to soak this in. It's not that every single time we get in a difficult situation, God's going to pull us out of it. That's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. But it's that in every single difficult situation, Jesus enters the situation with us. He's with us. How do we know that our God is faithful? How do we know that our God is trustworthy? He's been faithful before, and he's faithful today, because the faithfulness of God today is not dependent on the absence of problems, but it's on the presence of God in my life. See, our daughter Kingsley, I started to do things that I guess most kids do at a certain age. She gets up in the middle of the night and runs into our room. She gets up, and not only does she run into our room, she busts into our room like Kramer from Seinfeld. She's like, every night, and I wake up with a heart attack. Like, oh my gosh, we're under attack. So she buzzed into our room, and like I said, almost every night, and almost every time, what did she ask for? I need water. I gotta go potty. She goes potty, and then what? Can I leave at you and mommy? And then we're like, no. No, you can't sleep with us. Then comes the main reason. Then comes the main reason why she wants to come into our room. She says, well, my room is dark and there's a spider. And I'm like, what? She says, can you and mom come in my room? Can you and mom lay with me? And so this is what Aaron and I do pretty much every night. We will walk her back to her room. One of us will hop in the bed with her, tuck her in, and guess what? She'll instantly fall back asleep. Here's what I want you to see. Nothing changed about her bedroom. It's still dark. It's still the same bed. Still has the same blankets. The only thing that has changed is who's near her. It's being in the presence of one of her parents, someone trustworthy, that makes it easier to sleep. And friends, this is what I want you to get today. Your circumstances in life, they may not change for a long time. You're never going to hear from me, oh, if you come to Jesus, everything's going to be great. You're not going to have any problems. No, you're going to have a lot of problems. They're going to keep coming. They actually come more for Jesus followers, to be honest. You're going to have problems. But here's the good news of Jesus. Your circumstance may not change, but when you invite him near you, he lays beside you, and you will have supernatural rest, peace beyond your circumstances. People will look at you knowing what you're going through, and they'll say, how are you happy? Why are you joyful? You got this and that. And you can say with a proud testimony, my God is with me. He's for me. My God is faithful today. And the last thing I will say is this. Our God will be faithful tomorrow. He leads the Israelites to the edge of the promised land. He's been faithful before. He was faithful to get them there. But did the Israelites trust him? Did they go into the promised land? If you know the story, they didn't. They didn't trust him. They didn't trust him. They didn't step into the promised land. And here's what blows my mind about this story. The end of the story was already written. They already knew the end of the story. Because in Genesis chapter 12, God called Abram and said, I want to bless you so that you will be a blessing to the world. And I'm going to give you this land where you will be my people. They already knew that God was going to give them the land. Here you go. Right before they're about to go into the promised land, or attempt to go into the promised land, they send spies out to scout the promised land. And here's what God says to them. Numbers 13:1. The Lord said to Moses, send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which I am going to give to the Israelites. This promised land that was promised to them, they did not go in. And the reason why they didn't go in, this is my own opinion, it's because of forgetfulness. They forgot. Life circumstance hits you today and you can forget what God did yesterday. Life circumstance can hit in a way and it brings worry to you, brings stress to you, and it's easy to forget. And this encourages me because I don't know about you guys, but I do suffer from spiritual amnesia sometimes. But God, you were faithful back then. And since you were faithful back then, I know you will be faithful again. See, I don't know about you guys, again, I like to be honest, but sometimes I can even in my head say, oh, I know when God did this for us and did this for me and did this for us. And I know he's faithful today because we got the things that we got and we're living the life that we're living and it's pretty good. And I already know the victory is won through Christ on the cross and his resurrection, and we have a hope for eternity because of Jesus. Yet I still worry. Yet I still doubt. And I still wonder, will God come through for me this time? Is God trustworthy? Is he faithful? What happens when the thing you're worried about feels like it's about to happen? That's a fair question. And I ain't got one solution for you today. I'm going to take it to the scriptures, okay? I got a long portion of scripture I want to read, and I'm going to close with this thought, okay? I can tell you this. If you have time to worry about it, you do have time to pray about it. Matthew 6, in the Message paraphrase of the Bible, it says this. If you decide for God, living a life of God worship, it follows that you don't fuss about what's on the table at mealtimes or whether the clothes in your closet are in fashion. There's far more to your life than the food you put in your stomach, more to your outer appearance than the clothes you hang on your body. Look at the birds, free and not tied down to a job description, careless in the care of God. And I want you to give this. And you count far more to him than birds. Did you know that God loves you more than birds? If you decide for God, living a life of God worship, it follows that you don't fuss about those things. Has anyone, by fussing in front of a mirror, got any taller by much as an inch? All this time and money wasted on fashion, do you think it makes that much difference? Instead of looking at the fashion, walk out in the fields and look at the wildflowers. Come on. They never prep or shop. But have you ever seen color design quite like it? The 10 best dressed men in Nordstrom look shabby alongside them. People who don't know God in the way he works fuss over these things. But you know both God and how he works. Come on. Steep your life in God reality, God initiative, God provisions. Don't worry about missing out. You'll find all your everyday human concerns will be met. If God gives such attention to the appearance of wildflowers, which most are never ever seen, don't you think he'll attend to you, take pride in you, do his best for you? What I'm trying to do here is get you to relax and not be so preoccupied with getting so you can respond to God's giving. And this is the last thing I want you to get. Give your entire attention to what God is doing right now. Don't get worked up about what may or may not happen tomorrow. God will help you deal with whatever hard things come up when the time comes. All that to say, how do we live a life without worry? How do we know that God is trustworthy? Take one obedient step at a time. Just take one obedient step at a time, because God is trustworthy. Bow your heads with me. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you. We thank you that you are trustworthy. We thank you that you are good. Lord, help us to remember the good, the times you have worked. And since you have worked in our lives before, you are faithful to do it again. As for right now, the Holy Spirit saying, he's faithful to you. Don't listen to the lies. He's faithful. He sees you. Not only is our God trustworthy, he is powerful. So God, we lay our worries at your feet. You know what they are. We hand them over to you. And we say, have your way. Have your way, Lord, in us. Help us to remember. We love you and we need you. In Jesus' name, amen.